Right, so today we will begin Thomas Dekker's The Shoemaker's Holiday. At first we will discuss the background to the play. Now, as you may know that Thomas Dekker was more or less an exact contemporary of Shakespeare. He was born in 1572, whereas Shakespeare was born in 1564. Which means that Dekker was a few years younger, and Shakespeare died in 1616 and Dekker died in 1632. So we may say that he was one of the important Elizabethan dramatists, but he had to struggle a lot in order to get his reputation. But we may say that he succeeded, even though there was a kind of a dramatic tiff between Dekker and Ben Jonson. Dekker turned to writing satires at one point of time, and he wrote the Satiromastics, where he criticized Ben Jonson. Satiromastics. And Ben Jonson, in his turn, wrote a play named The Poetaster, where he ridiculed Dekker. Poetaster means one who tries to be a poet. So he ridiculed Dekker by calling him the Poetaster. But Dekker's immense success, we may say, established or maybe realized from the fact that his plays were performed in the Rose Theatre by the Lord Admiral's Men, that is Shakespeare's dramatic company. It was a rival to the group, the Lord Admiral's Men, which performed Dekker's plays. And this play, The Shoemaker's Holiday, was performed. It is recorded in the Elizabethan records that it was performed in the year 1600 before Queen Elizabeth I on the 1st January to celebrate the Christmas and the New Year. And critics believe that this play was earlier performed once in 1599. But that is a belief of the critics, but it is recorded that it was first performed in 1600, 1st January of the year 1600, before Queen Elizabeth. Therefore, unless Dekker were a prominent dramatist, his plays will not be performed before the Queen. Dekker also wrote a number of plays in collaboration with others, like with Thomas Middleton. With Middleton, he wrote The Roaring Girl, another city comedy like this one. And he also collaborated with John Day and some other Elizabethan dramatists. Now, the first important comment about this play is about its genre, that is, city comedy or citizen's comedy, as it was called. How is it different from conventional romantic comedy which Shakespeare and others wrote? It represents the citizen class, or we may say the artisanal class or the middle class. And city comedy represents city life, that is the life in London particularly. It is said that the play which Shakespeare wrote, which could be called to be nearest to a city comedy, was The Merry Wives of Windsor. But then Windsor is a small town, it is not a city. So it is not exactly therefore a city comedy. And critics do not think that Shakespeare wrote city comedies. Like many of Shakespeare's plays, particularly his history plays, we find a lot of historical elements or allusions in the play. And in this play, Dekker represents the Battle of Agincourt, which was fought in France. And the period which Dekker presents here is the 15th century. So even if the London life which Dekker represents here, that is the boisterous life of the Elizabethan period, but the historical background, the period which he is actually representing, is the 15th century, the reign of King Henry V. And as you know, that King Henry V was represented by Shakespeare in a number of historical plays. In King Henry V, King Henry IV Part 1, King Henry IV Part 2, and King Henry V, in these three plays, Shakespeare presents King Henry V. Therefore, historically, since Dekker is representing the 15th century London, therefore the king should be King Henry V. In the last scenes, 19 to 21, the king appears in this play, but Dekker does not specify whether he is King Henry V or King Henry VI. Since he was historically representing the period of King Henry V, so the king should be King Henry V. But probably it is King Henry VI, so we cannot be sure. Which means that even though Dekker is representing the impact of the Battle of Agincourt, the war with France in this play, he is not emphasizing the historical element so much as its effects on the life of the people of the city, particularly on the working class or on the artisanal class. So in this play he presents a character, Ralph, who goes to the war in France and comes back lame, comes back handicapped. So Dekker was not interested in the noble leaders or the aristocratic characters who participated in the war, unlike Shakespeare's history plays. Here we find a representation of the war from an opposite direction or an opposite angle, that is the effect of the war on the artisanal class, on the working class, and not the aristocratic leaders or the noblemen. The source of the play is a story by Thomas Delaunay, another contemporary, The Gentle Craft. The craft of shoemaking was known by the phrase The Gentle Craft, in which he provides a plot which is adapted by Dekker in this play. Dekker makes a few changes, but he retains the phrase, the gentle craft, in the title of this play. So the full title of the play is The Shoemaker's Holiday or The Gentle Craft. With the humorous life of Simon Eyre, shoemaker, and Lord Mayor of London, as it was acted before the Queen's Most Excellent Majesty on New Year's Day at night last, by the Right Honourable the Earl of Nottingham, Lord High Admiral of England, his servants. So the title page of the 1600 first edition of the Shoemaker's Holiday is reprinted in this New Mermaids series. So I am trying to show it to you. Can you see it? The the title, The Shoemaker's Holiday, here in the title sheet, there is no apostrophe before or after S, which means whether this play is about all the shoemakers or about one particular shoemaker, that is Simon Iyer, that is left ambiguous in this Elizabethan title. But modern editors, beginning from Fredson Bowers, have started giving an apostrophe. Harris's edition also contains an apostrophe after Shoemaker. Shoemaker's apostrophe after R, which means that it is about one shoemaker. So the this way, the ambiguity of the original title is lost, because Dekker obviously is not talking here about Simon Iyer only, but about all other shoemakers and the group of people or the class of people itself. Delaunay had taken the story of Simon Iyer from the real history of London, that one Simon Iyer from the artisanal class became the mayor of London. Dekker takes that story, Delaunay takes that story, and in Delaunay's The Gentlecraft, Simon Iyer is depicted both as a shoemaker and a draper. Draper means one who deals in cloth, a cloth merchant. Dekker, however, omits the reference to draper and makes Simon Iyer only a shoemaker, thus making the focus much more strongly upon the craft of shoemaking in this play. So as I am talking about the artisanal class, these people, they are also called the liveried men. Livery means a kind of particular dress for the servant or staff of a rich man or a nobleman. But liveried men refer to the guild houses of the Middle Ages. The guilds, each craft had its own guild in a city. So the shoemakers would have a guild, the drapers would have one, the metal workers would have another, the tinkers would have one, and so on. So people belonging to any craft could have a guild. And these guilds were like modern day trade unions to some extent, in the sense that they brought together the practitioners of a particular craft. And the norm was that a person who would like to learn this craft would remain apprentice with a master for 7 years at least. And after 7 years, he would be declared a craftsman on his own and would be given a license. So in this fashion, every person would belong to a particular house or a particular master. So nobody would be masterless. The English were afraid of masterless men, vagabonds, because the society was completely hierarchical. And everybody would have a master, and in turn he would be also a slave to somebody else. So in the feudal hierarchy, the artisanal class also retained this hierarchy. In this play we see a young aristocrat, Ronald Lacey, who falls in love with the daughter of a grocer. Roland Lacey is the nephew of the Earl of Lincoln, a nobleman. He falls in love with the daughter of the mayor of London. Now the mayor of London was Sir Roger Otley, who was actually a grocer. So you can see how this play represents the middle class, who would buy, who when they become rich, they would buy titles and can even become the mayor. So Roger Otley, even though he is a grocer, he has probably purchased knighthood and is called Sir Roger Otley. Otherwise, how will he deal with the aristocrats? Because the aristocrats were very snobbish and they would look down upon everybody. So for the bourgeois people, that is the townspeople or the middle class people, to deal with the aristocrats, they must also have some kind of a title. So we see this emphasis on a title in England. The aristocratic people were landed aristocracy. That is, they did not work, they did not have any profession other than fighting, they knew nothing. And they had huge quantities of land, and they survived on the rent received from this land. So this landed aristocracy, they always would have some title. Incidentally, the document for holding a land is also called a title deed. So you may imagine that without land you have no title. So the townspeople or the working class people, they won't have lots of land. So how would they have title? But through trade and commerce, they would become rich at that time. And once they became rich, then they would buy the title of a gentleman. So by becoming sir or by buying the title of a gentleman, they would become, they would rise in rank. They would then compete with the aristocrats. But the aristocrats' glory was in their birthright. That is, they were noble by virtue of their birth, which could not be purchased. So in France, there were two kind of noblemen. Noblemen by birth and noblemen by dress, noblesse de robe, by dress, which means that they purchased nobility or they purchased the title. And the king of France would sell the title of nobleman or nobility and knighthood and thus earn a lot of money. So Lacy, the nephew to the Earl of Lincoln, falls in love with his daughter Rose. Now, obviously he wants to marry Rose, but neither the Earl of Lincoln nor Sir Roger Otley wants this marriage to take place, because it would be an inter-class marriage. So in this extremely hierarchical society, everybody was afraid of an inter-class marriage. So Lincoln would have his nephew marry a girl from the nobility, not from the middle class. And Otley would have his daughter marry a man from the middle class and not from the nobility. So in order to prevent this marriage, Lincoln arranges with the king that Roland Lacy would be sent to the war in France. But Lacy finds a way to avoid military service. He sends one of his friends in his place to France and himself takes the disguise of a Dutch shoemaker and takes the name of Hans. Now, how could he take this disguise, or why that of a shoemaker? Because Lacy was a kind of a profligate, aristocrat, and had wasted all his wealth on the verge of being bankrupt. So he was forced to learn some craft in order to earn his, earn something to carry on his livelihood, and he decided to learn the art of shoemaking in Wittenberg in Germany, and he takes the Dutch name of Hans, the shoemaker, and he comes to Simon Eyer, who was himself a shoemaker, and many journeymen worked under him, and finds work with Simon in his shoe factory or in his guild, in his place. Now, out of all places, why does Dekker mention Wittenberg? Because when he mentions Wittenberg, then we are all reminded of Hamlet. Because in Shakespeare's Hamlet was a scholar at the University of Wittenberg. And Wittenberg is also famous for Martin Luther, and therefore it is associated with Protestantism. Well, now in Shakespeare's play, it is quite clear that Hamlet, who studied at the University of Wittenberg, develops a philosophical complexion, and therefore in Shakespeare's play, he behaves like a scholar, like a philosopher, rather than a soldier, and spends a lot of time, or wastes a lot of time, contemplating about what to do. That is quite consistent. But why in Dekker's play an aristocratic young man would take the guise of a shoemaker? And for that, why should he go to Wittenberg? Because Wittenberg was not renowned as a place for shoemaking, but it was renowned as a university town. So Hamlet becoming a scholar there was quite consistent with facts. It is probable that Dekker wanted also to put forward some latent Protestant sympathy in this play by making his hero learn shoemaking in Wittenberg. It is possible that he used Wittenberg because Wittenberg was a well-known town, and even though not well-known for shoemaking, but it would ring a bell and people would know where this place is. Whatever the reason, he makes it Wittenberg. And then another surprise, that Roland takes a Dutch name, and in this play he often speaks English with a Dutch accent. And through the language of Roland or Hans, we understand that Dekker knew, to some extent he knew Dutch, and probably the name Dekker is Dutch, and therefore it is possible that he had some Dutch lineage. Whatever the reason, he makes Hans, the shoemaker, a Dutch character, or Lacy takes the disguise of a Dutch shoemaker. Now, on the one hand, this is the main, in the main plot, Lacy tries to avoid going to France and to continue his affair with Rose, he takes this disguise and stays on in London. On the other hand, there is a subplot where Ralph, one of the shoemakers under Simon Eyer, is conscripted and goes to France, and his wife Jane is left alone, and before leaving, Ralph gifts her with a fine pair of shoes, and this pair of shoes was made by him as well as his colleagues, other shoemakers under Simon. Therefore, it was a kind of a collaboration, kind of a team effort, and when he left, then he also requested his friends to look after Jane, look after his wife. But Jane became alone and was forced to earn her living by tailoring or sewing. Now, as she was alone, a city gentleman named Hammond courts her and tries to marry her. When Ralph returns from war, some people come and give him the same pair of shoes which he had gifted to his wife and tells him a similar pair of shoes because this woman was going to get married and therefore a new pair of shoes was necessary. Ralph recognizes the pair of shoes and therefore realizes that somehow or other Jane is probably going to marry, and therefore when he comes to know where this occasion will be solemnized, he goes there and with his colleagues. At the same time, Lincoln and Otley come to know that Rose and Lacey are going to get married, and then they ask people, I mean the same people, salmoners, workers, where this occasion was being celebrated, and they deliberately tell him or give them the wrong information, and they send them to the church where Hammond was trying to marry Jane. And then Otley, Lincoln, they all appear there and they try to prevent that marriage. They stop that marriage. And in the meanwhile, Rose and Lacey have plenty of time to get married peacefully. So the marriage which should not have taken place, that is, Jane was already Ralph's wife, so she was kind of misguided by Hammond, who told her that her husband died in the war. Now, this marriage which should not have taken place is stopped. Ralph reclaims his wife. Hammond apologizes. And Lacey and Rose are married in another church. Then finally, Otley and Lincoln, they complain to the king. And they request the king to resign this marriage, to cancel this marriage between Lacey and Rose. The king initially says yes, he cancels this marriage, but then he again says that they should get married. So like a true diplomat, the king finds a diplomatic solution. He both cancels the marriage as the Earl and Otley wanted, and he also again marries them. So the comedy ends happily with Otley and Rose, with Lacey and Rose getting married and Ralph reclaiming his wife. So as you see, that this is a very interesting plot, interesting story, and the play is not difficult. The play is unlike the Shakespearean plays or even unlike Ben Jonson's comedies, mainly because it is a city comedy and therefore there is a representation of the working class or artisanal people in this comedy, particularly the group of shoemakers. The character of Simon Eyre is a prominent character here. Even though we cannot say that he is the hero, because the romantic couple Lacey and Rose, they would take the place of the protagonists. But Simon Eyre and his wife Marjorie, they are a hilarious couple. And Simon has a way of speaking, using a lot of slang, which gives Dacre plenty of opportunity to present the racy colloquial language of Londoners of that time. And Marjorie is also a very funny character. So through these characters and through the other shoemakers, Dacre is able to represent artisans or the working class people of London, which we do not find or cannot expect in the mainstream romantic comedy or even in Ben Jonson's comedy of humor. The City Comedy rose from Jonson's comedy of humor, but then it diverged and became a genre in itself. Now, apart from the funny and comic and hilarious side of the play, there is also an undertone of melancholy and danger in the representation of the constant fear of bankruptcy, because the period that the Elizabethan period, it was a time when there was a lot of uncertainty and ups and downs in the economic spheres. People were losing land, or they were becoming, they were coming to the city for employment. People were lacking employment, and some of them would become suddenly rich through trade and commerce. So there would be a class of nouveau riche or newly rich, and there would be the skilled artisans who would rise very slowly through their services as craftsmen. Conflict between the landed gentry or landed aristocracy and the bourgeois middle class would find a lot of reverberation, lot of reflection in the lives of the people, lot of impact on the daily lives of the people, and people lived a very uncertain life, and through a very uncertain time they would lead their lives. So bankruptcy was common, as we see here that Roland Lacey was almost bankrupt. Even though he was a nobleman, he survived by learning the art of shoemaking. There are references to the Lord of Ludgate, which alludes to Lud, an ancient mythical king of England, or London. And the name of the town of London, city of London, was from Lud. And at the gate of the city, there was a statue of Lud, the Lord of Ludgate. And on the other side of the gate was another statue of Queen Elizabeth. And nearby there was the Ludgate prison. So the Ludgate prison was reserved for bankrupts. So those who went bankrupt, they would go to Ludgate prison. Therefore, in this play we see that Simon Eyre suddenly becoming rich. He is helped by Hans, or Roland Lacey in the guise of Hans, who introduces him to the captain of a ship, a merchant ship, who was making a distress sale of the luxury commodities of his ship, because probably he didn't have the license to sell them. So he was selling them at a throwaway price. And Simon purchased the whole lot of merchandise by taking some loan from Lacy, and then he sold them at a very high price, and as a result he quickly became very rich. And once he became very rich, then he was also elected as the mayor of London. So through Simon we also find the story of somebody becoming quickly rich. So that is the other aspect or other side of the story of somebody rich becoming bankrupt. In general, these stories contribute to the latent instability and uncertainty in the play. And as a result, there is always a sense of fear of bankruptcy and going to the prison or suffering and so on, which finds reflected also in the language of the play. And sometimes the characters hope to be pardoned by the king or the queen for their bankruptcy, that they are not sent to the prison and so on. What is
luge means
flood, LUD. Lud is a mythical king of London or England, a mythical king. The city of London is named after him, and the Ludgate prison is named after him also. Okay, so we find here a depiction of mercantile capitalism, and you also find a reference to a lot of things, actual things, items of merchandise or luxury items, and things take upon themselves a glory or an aura. They become very important in the lives of the people, which is a sign of the kind of emphasis that wealth suddenly got in history. Because this was the period of acquisition of capital, as Karl Marx had theorized that it was the period of acquisition of primitive capital, and therefore the sudden value that wealth or luxury items that they got from this ambient ethos of the time of mercantile capitalism, and we find a reference to a lot of things, lot of luxury items here in this play. And this also is fruitfully exploited by the Lord Admiral's men, who had many stage properties which could be used as the representation of things, of valuable items on the stage. So we'll look at this aspect of the play also. It seems that you do not have any questions. So get hold of the play and read it. One thing that I may tell you is that Fredson Bauer first divided the play into acts and scenes, into a five-act structure. But that was not very successful. The play originally was made of 21 scenes, and this edition, New Mermaid's edition, it preserves the 21 scenes structure, and there are no acts, or there is no act division in this edition, which was the original structure of the play. But this edition has a very good introduction. So you should all read the introduction, and in the appendix also you have the you have excerpts from Delaunay's The Gentle Craft. So the question that you are asking about source, that question will be answered. You can look at some excerpts. And in the frontispiece, that is the first page, there is a picture of the Rose Theater, the hexagonal open theater without a roof. That is very clear in the sketch.